Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
So this is another story from the Paladin DM that also goes by Lord Althory. If you like his work, you should check out his Subscribestar to support him directly, or check out his YouTube channel linked to down below. And with that out of the way, let's get into the story. Kill Team Equinox Chapter 12, Treachery and Contempt. Aetra, Matthias, and a number of the new captains were soon assembled inside one of the command bunkers a few rings back from the walls. It was still largely intact, although the Manticore battery on its top was currently undergoing repairs. It had suffered a direct hit during the first attack, which had melted through one of the main support joints and caused it to collapse. As they entered, Aetra shivered as she watched the servitors hauling in materials, and the inhuman tech priests performing the rituals of repair and reconstruction. Inside, she recognized several former sergeants she had fought alongside, now elevated to higher rank just as she was. The few former officers remaining were there as well, and she noted each in turn. She had never had the good fortune of serving directly under them, but heard from reputation that each one was competent, brave, and loyal. There were six captains here, each with an adjutant. Each one seemed uncomfortable in their new uniform, with faintly humming Aquila. It was somewhat reassuring to know that she wasn't alone and dreading her new command. To her surprise, it was not Morn standing ready to direct their efforts, but rather Aishvan. The salamander quickly explained that his battle brother was currently in conference with the forces of the Manufactorum and naval elements, working to increase security and recover the sunken Titan. Aetra was amazed to hear that the god machine was still functional, and apparently continuing the fight alongside the submarine elements. Then again, considering the arcane and incredible technologies used in its creation, should she have been? Aishvan began to explain the situation. As you know, we recently repelled the first probing attack from the Xenos. Thanks to the intervention of the Titan and your own remarkable courage and stoicism, we accomplished a decisive defense. However, it has become clear that the initial attack was in fact a distraction. During the battle, a number of Xenos known as Genostelos infiltrated the Underhive. To make matters worse, during the battle the equivalent of a brigade also defected. We believe them to have been infested, a sort of Xenos human hybrid who have now shown their true colors. Aetra sucked in a breath. The Xenos were capable of something like that? She had read the Infantryman's Uplifting Guide, and it had described certain types of Xenos capable of controlling humans. The Enslavers, a race of heretical Xenos which used unstable Sickers as gateways from their worlds to the Imperium, came to mind. But a union of alien and human flesh, particularly something as alien as the Tyranid? It caused her blood to boil and her stomach to churn in disgust. Aishvan continued. The enemy forces are primarily comprised of these traitorous guardsmen and similar hybrids. Their armaments will be slightly below your own as they will be relying on stolen equipment. We have confirmed that they do not have any tank support, and a large number of the cultists will be using primitive or improvised weapons such as stubbers. However, they will be linked by the hive mind, and thus have an advantage in command and control. However, he warned, they do possess a number of highly dangerous bioforms. Firstly, the infiltration consisted primarily of pure strain Genostelos. While they are relatively few in number, they are intelligent, adept at stealth, and extremely dangerous in close combat. They are most likely led by broodlords, particularly large and dangerous bioforms that also possess psionic abilities. The enemy general is most likely a Genostela Patriarch, a particularly dangerous psionic bioform. Aetra nodded. So despite their Xenos blood, they would be like fighting most rebels, under-equipped but numerous. Unlike most rebels though, they would be highly coordinated. She began to run over potential threats. Mines and traps would be a certainty, as would ambushes. The broodlords would be the most significant threat. A single hive tyrant had managed to butcher several of her veteran squads and had been destroyed more due to luck than anything else. These creatures wouldn't necessarily be as powerful, but their ability to evade detection meant they wouldn't be able to engage it until it was practically on top of them. Aishvan then gave each of them their assignments. As Aitra suspected, he proposed a methodical approach. Each captain would take command of a spurtip which would push into the underhive along one of the six main spires. Each brigade would have additional support from Arbites and gangs to help navigate the area. The brigades would largely be expected to clear traitor guardsmen resistance themselves, but would receive some heavy support elements from the Mechanicus. Aitra grinned at the mention of heavy support. The manufacturers of Alvaro were primarily dedicated to creating seafaring vessels for the Imperium, particularly the Paracles, for which they possessed something called an STC. However, they did manufacture a few land-based vehicles. Most notably, the wider machine cult had granted Alvaro dispensation to create a specific, ancient tank uniquely suited to conflicts on the massive bridges and inside the great hives, the defender pattern of the Malkada heavy tank. Even a single Malkada would prove an incredible boom in this mission, and the defender pattern, while originally developed for use against the orcs, would be perfect for engaging the Tyranid hordes in these tighter quarters. As the meeting drew to a close, Aitra nodded to Matthias, and the two retreated to plan with their Arbites and Ganger attachments. Aishvan prepared to return to some other duty, but paused when he spotted a pair of Gangers conversing. One of them had a tattoo on his arm, which was nothing special, if not for what it was. It was a grey shark, with tail curved so it nearly reached the head and formed a circle. Aishvan approached the Gangers curiously. "You, what is that on your arm?" he asked the man, pointing to the tattoo. "Oh," the man said with surprise, having either not noticed the space marine, an impressive feat, or actively resisted noticing him in hopes he wasn't coming over to him. "That gov? It's a Caradon, cause I'm with the Caradons. There's a gang around there. We got dragged up by the bobbies over yonder and they told us we'd be crumped if we weren't there to guide the guard down to smash up the bugger gits." Aishvan blinked, and was grateful he had his helmet. "Caradon, do you mean a car Caradon?" he asked, wondering now both on the origin of the symbol, and the addition of orc slang to the ganger's vocabulary. "No governor, I don't think so. What would a car Caradon even be?" he asked, looking towards his friend for support. The other ganger shrugged. "I dunno. Sounds like a proper hard and great big Caradon to me, like a space marine Caradon. Emperor, that'd be something to see. Actual Caradons. They're a great big fish bugger, about as wide as a jit and twice as long, mouthful of teeth, that is governor," the ganger explained somewhat nervously. "They're a right proper batch of scrappers. Hate to be on the bad side of a car Caradon. Indeed you would. I try to avoid it myself," Aishvan responded, then walked away with a smile. As he did so, he voxed Constantine. "Brother, was this planet attacked by orcs during its history perchance?" The Templar was silent for a moment, then responded. "Yes, roughly 2 millennia ago. They laid siege to the major hives before the Wog was defeated by the efforts of the Car Caradon Astra?" Aishvan ventured a guess. Constantine was silent for a long moment longer. "Yes. How did you know that?" "I'll tell you later," Aishvan replied, and ended the connection. It took another few hours for the forces to be properly assembled, scouting parties to be sent out, and divisions reorganized into their new formations. It was a frenzied few hours, as Aitra and Matthias set to work planning, and then Matthias set to work politicking to acquire the additional war gear they would need. Once that was accomplished, their brigade and attached support elements moved into the depths. Aitra's forces were not insubstantial. Leading the way were 60 guardsmen, divided into 6 squads, each one led by a newly promoted sergeant. Each one was also accompanied by either an Arbites or gang member which served as guide, and a servitor equipped to disarm mines or other traps. They advanced slowly and cautiously, maintaining constant radio contact. In the second wave marched various reactive elements, ready to deploy as needed. There were 2 squads of Ogrins and one of the larger Bulgrins, as well as 2 squads of veterans equipped with shotguns and flamers. Aitra and her command squad, including Matthias, marched here as well. It had taken quite a bit of effort from the former captain, but each member of the command squad was now equipped with a plasma gun. Aitra had learned her lesson from the battle in the tower. Metalus might be supremely effective at killing things, but with their relatively short range they would be too slow to reach the enemy, and if they failed to kill it the squad was almost certainly lost. In this position, they would quickly respond with devastating firepower towards any larger bioform that showed itself. Finally, bringing up the rear came the heavy support. Trundling along, at times struggling to fit through the tight corridors of the Underhive, a veritable rolling fortress, bristling with firepower. No less than 7 heavy bolters protruded from its sponsoons, and a mighty devastator cannon swept from side to side on its turret. Towering over even the Ogryns, and covered in more heavy armor than even a Lemon Russ, it was the Malkador Defender, a venerable and devastating heavy tank. While not so heavily armed as a Banner Blade, or as well armored as a Land Raider, it was perfect for this situation. About it came the red-robed cybernetic defenders of the Manufactorum, the Skittery, and with them an Angi Seer to maintain the machine. Aitra had also ordered a heavy weapons squad armed with Laskanans to move alongside the tank in the event they required anti-tank firepower. They proceeded into the Underhive slowly, almost agonizingly so. Outside they could hear the dull sloshing of the tides against the great pillars of the hive, dark waters where even now submarines and a titan wage war against the aquatic Xenos. The air was thick with the stench of a hive city's waste, even through her gas mask Aitra could smell it. The stink was occasionally punctuated by the smell of mildew, as the marching troops splashed through the damp tunnels. Strange things skittered and lurched, mutants, insects, and unwholesome things. Each one was responded to with a volley of Laskan fire, each area carefully checked for traps. Yet despite this, it was quiet. The Underhive was a festering jungle, full of rejected life, but now it was silent. New predators had entered the jungle, fearsome enough that all the madness cast off by society could not crush them. So they hid, and they waited for the two sets of intruders to clash and destroy one another. Fortunately, they were only headed into the shallows of the Underhive, just a few hundred meters below the waves where the Genestealers had entered the city. Here in these shallows there was toxic sludge and leaks and mutants and gangers and all manner of other uncomfortable things, but at least it wasn't the depths. Not even the gangers and Arbites went that far down, past where the sigils of the Imperium still held some fundamental sway, save for isolated chapels preserved by ghosts. Down where the truly mad and horrific things were born, lived, and died kilometers beneath the waves in the great spire pillars. Nobody knew what lay at the basest portion of the hive, at the seafloor, and perhaps beneath. Legend said the hive tunneled beneath the seafloor, dredging up magma from the planetary core to power arcane machinery which upheld the hives. Rumors spoke of men of clockwork and brass, of technology forgotten, and symbols that predated even the Imperium. But many say many foolish things, and such heretical whispers were dealt with swiftly. Still, nobody went down that deep, not even the Xenos were that mad. Still, the rumors and tales of nameless things, things forgotten, and things erased still permeated upwards. Ghost stories were bad enough. Ghost stories when they actually were fighting monsters that lived in the dark were unacceptable. Aitra monitored the communications of her men carefully, keeping an ear and rebuking senseless chatter sharply. Kill Team Equinox Chapter 12.5, Treachery and Contempt Part 2. After a few hours of careful exploration, during which they disarmed no fewer than 28 booby traps, mines, and other obstacles without any major casualties, they entered a large waste processing area. Here things opened, as pipes ran across a broad steel floor and among a web of such in the ceiling. Towards the back of the room stairs led upwards to some sort of expansive control center, set like a bunker onto a plateau of permacrete and iron railings. Across the floor, servitor and servo skull parts lay scattered, blood and oil staining the already dirty surface. Towards the back of the room the scouts could see sandbags and other defensive emplacements, but they appeared to be unmanned. This reeks of a trap. Aitra growled, looking around. I agree. Matthias agreed. Though the question is what to do about it. We've yet to encounter the enemy, and if we cause them to attack when they expect us to be surprised, we may be able to take advantage of their overconfidence. Agreed, though we don't know how many forces are concentrated here. Get on the Voxhaler and see if we can establish contact with the other formations. Aatra ordered. Matthias complied, and they soon established contact. Formations Beta and Gamma had engaged the enemy, but encountered only minor resistance, and were quickly rolling through. Formation Delta was out of contact, and Formation Epsilon reported that they were currently engaging notable Xenos and traitor forces, but were having some success, before the transmission failed. Aatra frowned, cursed at the Voxhaler, kicked it, and sighed. The Tech Priest examined it and reported, aside from a minor dent, it was perfectly functional. Aatra swore that it was glaring at her, but its eyes were mechanical, and she had a hard time reading them. Right. This is almost certainly some kind of ambush, but we might be able to turn the scales on them. Listen up. She then quickly explained her plan to the staff. If we trigger it, then this will give us a better chance. If it's not a trap, we can link up and press on. She looked up at the ganger and the Tech Priest. Can you make this work? The ganger, a heavily scarred giant who looked like he was half Ogryn, cracked his neck. Gov, these places are a balmy mess and we're likely to be running into the buggers. Even with the support you're after, it's a mess, could be a bit slow. The Tech Priest pondered for a time, then nodded. It can be accomplished if there is a point to establish point of contact. It replied. Right. What do you mean by a point to establish point? Aatra asked. Beacon. Signal. Flare. Pharos. Sign. Has to be non-visual. Would something broadcasting Vox work? Yes. The Tech Priest replied. Aatra nodded and pulled her spare Vox bead from her front pocket. She had been given a more advanced one following her promotion, but kept the old one. The Tech Priest took it and quickly examined and tweaked it, before handing it back. Activate. Will produce point. Will burn out battery and need replacing. Aatra nodded. Understood, I'll get it fixed up after we're done here. Then she rose. Alright. You have your orders. God Emperor willing, I'm just being paranoid, but if not, then let's kill some bloody Xenos. The plan set into motion. Two squads moved forwards cautiously up the center of the large room, while two more moved along the flanks close behind them. The remaining two squads moved up further behind them, keeping hidden but ready to rush forwards. Alongside them the Ogryns waited, grinning stupidly. They were going to get to squish more bugs. Aatra waited beside them with her command squad. They were planning to ambush an ambush. It wouldn't do for the scheme to be ruined by the stupid Abhumans. Matthias waited not far from her, with the special weapons teams around him. He checked the lenses on his LAS pistols, and double-checked the power packs and his spares. He nodded to his captain, who returned it with a slight incline of her head. Her eyes were fixed on the men and on the elevated platform. Her stomach churned, her body felt cold and hot all at once, and she tasted bile in the back of her throat. Yet in spite of this, her mind was calm and cold. Adrenaline roared through her veins, her hand itched, grasping faintly for the handle of her chainsword or plasma gun. Her breaths were slow and steady. As the first two squads drew near, the expected occurred. Once they were within range, traitors dressed in guardsmen uniforms burst from the command center and began to lay down fire on the advancing squads. The moment the enemy showed themselves, Matthias activated his Vox bead and sent a one-word warning. Confirm. The infantry received and fell back smoothly, just as they had planned. By the time the enemy was firing, they were already in cover behind the pipes and valves. They began to return fire in good order as the enemy presented themselves, downing several overeager traitors. Four traitor squads had revealed themselves to the two scouts, forcing the loyalists to hunker down. Two pairs of the hybrids rushed to waiting heavy bolters, and the sergeants ordered their squads further back as the mass reactive shells began to punch through cover and into flesh. But even as the center began to execute an orderly retreat, the flanks pressed in while their comrades distracted the enemy. On the left flank, they moved over easier terrain and so managed to close the distance quickly. The sergeant gave the order, and each man seized a fragmentation grenade from his belt. As one, they pulled the pins and hurled the grenades up onto the enemy. The hybrid scattered, as a wave of explosions tore their defensive position apart, shredding through the Xenos scum. The squad on the left rushed to cover as the enemy rallied and began suppressing their position. Their revelation set the enemy to watch their other flank as well, and the heavy bolter roared to life. Fortunately for that squad, the terrain which slowed them also provided cover thick enough to resist the mass reactive shells. Then the smoke turned, and Atra's hand dropped. The Ogrims let out a shout of glee and charged forwards, slab shields raised and mauls ready. The command squad moved not far behind. Across from them, Matthias ordered the special weapons teams on forwards even faster. Their timing was perhaps even a moment soon, a hasty decision based on snap reactions. They rushed forwards into position somewhat heedlessly of cover, focused entirely on speed. It was still too late, and they were still too slow. From the smoke burst humanoid horrors, the pure strain. Here the Xeno stood in all its revolting glory, leaping and bounding with terrific speed. They were disgusting creatures, vaguely humanoid with oversized wrinkly heads and mouths full of sharpened teeth and purple tongues. Their bodies were covered in leathered, wrinkly hides and chitinous plating. They moved on four limbs, human-like hands at the end of the forelimb, clawed feet at the rear. From where their shoulders met their back rose two crooked insectoid limbs, each tipped with a set of three razor-sharp claws. Atra knew that they were deadly in melee, and that they were swift, but having never faced them, was utterly unprepared for just how swift. They moved unnaturally swiftly, leaping across the gap and crossing over the obstacles in seconds. The guardsmen attempted to retreat, but caught off guard by their speed and sudden appearance, they were slow moving. One fell behind as two pounced on him. He vanished under a storm of fang and rending, flesh and armor shredded like paper. The Jenna Steelers caught four more, ripping them off their feet. There were brief, piercing screams as they were dragged back into the oncoming horde, and then silence as they were torn to pieces. The fifth one to fall grabbed the other grenade and pulled the pin, and the explosion halted the Xenos for a moment, allowing the rest of the squad to escape. Go. 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 Atra shouted. The two reserve squads raced up ahead of the Ogrins and opened fire. Red LAS blasts crossed the distance in an instant, forcing the Jenna Steelers to dodge behind cover, allowing the mangled squad to pull back. The Ogrins started to charge, but Atra ordered a halt. You lot. Left. She ordered, pointing to the left. To the left, there were of course, more Jenna Steelers. They had raced in to flank the retreating squad, but now pushed on to counter the counter-assault. Their sheer numbers would be enough to overwhelm even the mighty Ogrins, but fortunately for the Abhumans, Matthias was about to reduce that advantage. All ranks. Up and fire. He roared as the flamer teams raced into range. Raising his pistols, he opened fire, blasting two perfect holes through two Jenna Steeler faces. The battle cries of the Xenos were drowned out by the whoosh of Promethium, as the flamer teams unleashed their fury. Even the agile Xenos could not escape the flame, and their limited armor and weak frames were perfect targets for a Promethium baptism. They pivoted in their charge smoothly towards the flamers, charging without any concern for their own safety. The Ogrims charged, too stupid to fear the flame, not that they needed to. Their heavy armor, sheer bulk, and resilient slab shields would render the flamers virtually useless against them. They crashed into the splintering Jenna Steeler swarm and utterly shattered it, crushing the frail Xenos with swings of their mighty mauls. But as they moved to finish the creatures, they staggered, looking about in a daze. Then a shadow moved from the periphery and was among them. In a blur, two heads went flying from their necks, dazed and confused expressions still on their faces. The bonehead, an Ogryn sergeant, had enough presence of mind to raise his shield, and it spared him a moment more. The thing struck his mighty slab shield, digging into the permacrete and sticking. The creature paused for a moment, and Atra took it in. It was a massive creature, even taller than the Ogryns, even taller than Eichmann, yet with a slight frame. It was built like the Jenna Steelers, but instead of having human-like hands, it had two mantis-like blades at the end of its second set of appendages. It was covered in heavier bony armor, but moved even more swiftly. Clearly this was this brood's lord. Aethra grit her teeth and raised her weapon command, "Take aim," she ordered. In the moment it took the command squad to raise their weapons and charge them, the bonehead died. The broodlord jerked its embedded arm to the side, pulling the shield away from the addled up human's body. The scything talons struck, severing both of the ogryn's arms, and then the other claw swept across and cut the unfortunate's bony head from his bulky body. However, the time it took it to slaughter the ogryn squad cost the monster its own existence. "Fire!" Aethra roared. The command squad's plasma gun screamed, blue fire crossing the gap between the monster and themselves in an instant. Even at this virtually point-blank range, the creature moved with almost supernatural speed. It evaded Aethra's own blast, but the second struck it in the leg. The bone armor was vaporized, and the creature began to fall. The remaining blast struck it across its midsection, and it exploded in a flash of blood and plasma. The remaining 9 ogryns staggered back to their feet. "Go around, smash the bugs," Aethra ordered them, waving them around. "Third squad, pull back and move up the center. Fifth, cover them. Command and fourth on me. Second, left back and grenade off their cover. Matthias, forwards to support the ogryns." With that, Aethra started venting her plasma as she moved forwards to flank the Genestealers. Matthias chuckled. "Yep. She's perfect for commanding the big guys." Then he ordered his men forwards and led the way, las pistols blasting. The overextended Xenos attempted to pull back, as Matthias led the flame squads and the ogryns towards their position. Second squad unleashed fury into them from the flank, and Aethra charged in from the side. The surviving heavy bolter turned its blast towards her. The first shot went through a pipe and deflected to the side, the second whipped past her head, and the third seemed ready to strike home when it deflected against a crackling energy shield. Plasma, LAS, and flamer blast alike utterly destroyed the overextended formation. A single smoldering Xeno raced into range, talons lunging for the command squad. Aethra slipped her plasma gun to her side and her chainsword roared. The Xeno stepped back from her initial strike, countering with its claws. Aethra shifted her foot and grip, bringing her blade into a relentlessly practiced defense. With a snap, the Genestealer's claws went flying, mangled stumps remaining, before Aethra cut down, severing the Xeno's head from its body in a bloody spray. "You're slow," she commented, before ducking behind cover. The enemy's counter-thrust shattered. Aethra ordered the ogryns forwards. First and second squad moved up behind them, using the bulky abhumans as cover. Fourth and the remains of third held back with the flamer squads, ready for another counter-attack. All the while fifth and sixth squad hammered suppressing fire onto the Xenos. As the abhumans began to climb the stairs, Aethra grinned. Victory was so very near. And then doom fell upon the brigade. A wave of sickness, dread and despair that radiated out from the control center. Aethra leaned on the pipe she was taking cover behind, breathing heavily. Another member of command squad collapsed, retching. Then the discomfort grew worse, a screaming gnashing, the chanting roaring of a thousand minds falling upon their own. Discomfort turned to pain, pain turned to agony, and it struck the whole brigade as one. The ogryn stopped, then turned. They raised their mauls, and brought them down on their own allies. They moved clumsily, jerkily, like puppets on strings, but against the crippled squads it was enough. The Genestealers began to fire casually, taking their time to line up kill shots on the helpless guardsmen. Aethra struggled to raise herself up, and looked into a face of death, looming above the ogryns. At the peak of the stairs was a gargantuan Genestealer, larger even than the Broodlord. It walked about on four limbs, while its upper two directed its minions. It was covered in thick black plating, and seemed to shimmer as she looked upon it. The more she looked at it, the greater the pain felt. A thousand screaming gnashing minds, bound together in an avatar of psionic power, scraping against her mind. She tried to move her limbs, but they would not respond. The ogryns drew nearer, having finished massacring the squads nearest to them. So this was the patriarch. Aethra cursed it in her mind. She could still think, still feel, but her mind seemed trapped inside her own body. This level of psychic might was unlike anything she had even considered. The power of the Hive Tyrant had been direct and brutal, tearing her men apart. This was worse, an insidious evil that plumbed the cracks of her mind and held her helpless before the swarm. She fell to her knees, limbs shaking. Her gums bled, her eyes felt like they were going to explode. The Ogryns were getting closer. Aitra pitied them. Poor creatures, not even fully human, now puppets for the vile Xeno. For a moment a treacherous thought crossed her mind. Give up. Give in. Perhaps you will live. Even if you do not, then the pain will end. No mind to understand she was about to die, no more screaming agony, not even the pain of a maul crushing her skull. No. Almost as soon as the idea crossed to her mind, it was rejected, violently. That was treachery, heresy. A fire lit in her soul, and her fists clenched. She raised up her head, then staggered, almost drunkenly to her feet. She would die, yes, but all men died. She brought to mind Constantine, standing alone upon the bridge against the swarm, Wathin, leaping from the gate to destroy a titan. Ishvan, fighting in the dark alongside fellow guardsmen, even risking his life to protect her. Morn, standing implacable among the storm. Andriel, whose powers exposed him to suffering like this each day. She was no Astartes. She was merely mortal, but they had chosen her, considered her worthy to stand alongside them even if only for a time. She rose, facing the patriarch. Its powers were too great to allow her to raise her weapon, but she had one last card to play. Its power seemed to focus on her, as she reached into her pocket for the vox bead. It hammered down on her, trying to force her to her knees, but she would not die kneeling. The agony intensified, but she bore it with bitter contempt. Her face twisted into a sneer, as she drew out the vox bead and activated it. Her mind burned, the screaming golden hot, and she armored herself in all her duty, in all her hatred, in all her contempt. She took a step forwards. This thing, this worm, this subhuman animal dared to come to her planet, to her city, to corrupt her men, to kill her soldiers, to elicit such heretical thoughts from her mind. Her fury and contempt burned golden and consumed her so utterly that she could no longer feel the pain of the psychic attack. She met the patriarch's gaze, human purple eyes burning into alien ones. For the Emperor. She screamed, with such vitriol that her throat bled. She raised up the vox bead, and cast it forwards. The bead landed with a faint, anticlimactic clack at the patriarch's feet. The Xeno looked down to evaluate the threat, and looked up at Aitra. Through its cyclic attack, she could sense confusion. Then an explosion rocked the room, as the wall to the left of the command center vanished in the brilliant flare of a melter charge. The patriarch turned to face this new threat, when a second, deeper boom sounded through the room, followed by the roar of a rocket. Instants later, a demolisher cannon round punched through the smoke, and the side of the command room, into the patriarch's chest. The monster went flying off to the side, before the round burst, scattering it into a thousand pieces. Roaring out of the smoke, the Malkada defender came. Aitra had ordered it to outflank the enemy. Using the modified vox bead as its signal, they struck the enemy with their mightiest blow when it was least expected. Roaring into the stunned cultists, the heavy bolters mounted all across its chassis opened fire in all directions. The hybrids died like flies. With this overwhelming threat in their heart and the death of their god, the cult broke and fled. With the spell broken, Aitra screamed to pursue them, chasing after them with chainsword raised and bloody murder in her eyes. It took the combined efforts of the command squad and Matthias to hold the blood-mad captain back and sit her down. By the god Emperor. Aitra, you're bleeding out of your ears, stop and get some medical attention before you run off and get eaten. Matthias begged her as he held her chainsword arm back and desperately evaded the roaring blade. A few moments later the divine, through from what god is somewhat questionable, rage subsided and Aitra sat down groggily. She was in fact bleeding quite badly from her ears, eyes, nose, and mouth, and her whole body ached. Her eyes in particular ached, and she was having trouble seeing. Intense pressure from the Xeno's witchcraft results in damage to capillaries throughout the body, particularly the head. commonly accepted side effect of resisting psychic powers. Metal eyes, the Tech Priest explained. Particularly prevalent in blood vessels around eyes. Vision likely hampered by 17%. Replacements or visual aids will be required. It explained, injecting her with an anesthetic. Thanks, Cogboy. Guess I'll put my new officer's pay towards glasses. Aitra grumbled. Also, where's the actual medic? I'm not a tank. Company medic was eaten by Jenna Steelers. You are not a tank. You are a biological machine. Also, I am a woman. Metal Eyes explained. Wait, what? Aitra asked as she looked up. She examined the Tech Priest more closely. I couldn't tell. Also, I didn't think you lot really were men or women. Just, you know, metal. The flesh is weak, but we are men and women. Metal Eyes explained. She pulled back her hood, revealing brown hair mixed in with wires, and the tanned skin of an Alvaran. The flesh is weak, but humanity is not. Anything without humanity is an abomination. Ha! Aitra grunted, still woozy from her headache, and also now the painkillers. Ah, shit. I never got your name. To be honest, I didn't think you had one. I am Mara Cognis. The Tech Priest explained, then offered her hand to shake. Aitra shook it. The hand was cold, but not inhuman. Sorry about that, it was, I suppose, quite rude. To be honest, you lot scare the shit out of me most days, not sure why we're talking. You are exhausted, have suffered a head injury, and are on painkillers. Mara replied. Your adrenaline response is also entirely spent for the moment. You are physically incapable of being afraid. Query, why do you normally produce a fear response? Not sure. You just don't seem human, and you're also always with those servitors. Aitra shivered. I know those were people once, the thought of something like that. Same fear that let me fight the attack, I think. You fear servitude perpetuous. This is good. It is meant to be this way, and only a deficient would not. Mara agreed. The fear is necessary, as is their function. Both are required to maintain the machine of the Imperium. Yeah, I get that. Don't like it all the same. I am not fond of waste disposal systems. They remain necessary. These ones will require extensive repairs considering the damage inflicted by driving a heavy tank through them. Hep, fair enough. I am pleased to see you appear to remain sane. Your actions had produced doubt as to that fact. Crazy like a fox? What is a fox? I have no idea, but apparently they're very clever but also crazy. I must find a fox and evaluate it. Good luck with that. First, let's get these bugs off our planet. Agreed. First you must sleep though. Mara replied, and then injected her with something else. Aitra regained consciousness looking at the ceiling. Her headache had diminished to a dull roar, and she had full function again. She was thinking clearly, and her first thought was, it's a damn good thing I'm a captain now or I'd be shot for sleeping on the job. The benefits of command, and having subordinates who also know how to do the job. Matthias remarked. Oh, you're still alive, thank the Emperor. Aitra said as she sat up from the bedroll and looked around. They were in the control center of the room the battle had taken place in. You're a good shot with those pistols, by the way. Lots of dueling practice, and I'm not crazy enough to try to resolve my honor with a chainsword. Matthias explained. Don't knock it until you've spent a week practicing how to hold it properly. Bloody space marines, they're insane. They're as good as the stories say, but they are completely insane. Matthias chuckled. I was considering writing a report for you, but I'll give you the short version. We're winning, handily. Cut off the head and the body will wither is as true for the Tyranids as it is for orcs. It's less the body withering and more the body fighting itself to the death trying to be the new head with greenskins. Aitra noted, then cracked her neck. Glad to hear it. Make sure they know who gets the credit. Roger that. I've been trying to hail Lord Morn, but I can't get through. He explained. We're fairly far down, that's to be expected. How long was I out? About 4 hours. Metal Eyes. Mara said you'd need fluids and nutrient paste when you woke up, even though you probably won't be hungry for the next couple of days. Couple of days? What did she hit me with? Something they use on skittery, I suppose. Puts them under so you can repair them. How the hell did we overwrite Jenna Steelers? Right. Let's move back up a few floors and try it there. I'll eat on the way. She grumbled, reaching into her pack and retrieving a few tubes of nutrient paste and her canteen. She drank both on her way back up the hive. Supposedly officers ate better. Maybe it was more nutritious paste, but it was the same flavorless goo as ever. As she washed it down, she pondered whether the better eating was in fact just higher quality alcohol to wash the goo down with. As they traversed back further up the spire, accompanied by Matthias's squad and command, the Voxhaler crackled into life. Repeat, Lictor is attempting to terminate the astropathic choir, unable to contain. Request immediate support. Morn's voice crackled through. Aitra quietly felt her bowels sink into her feet, but she did her duty. Roger that, Lord Morn. My brigade is on its way. Aitra replied. Command, with me, Matthias, Vox the others and get them to cover our cleanup, then get the rest of the brigade up to support. Matthias stared. The entire brigade? Even the tank? Yes, the entire brigade. The Astartes are calling for backup. If I had a Titan, I'd bring that too. Aitra growled, then turned and raced with command towards the nearest lift towards the upper spire. She voxed back as she ran. Mara, can you potentially get a salamander towards our entry point? I need to get to the astropathic choir immediately. You what? Mara asked in genuine confusion. Aitra explained the situation and the Tech Priest replied. I do not have the authority to requisition a vehicle, but I will inform Imagos that Tech Priest Morn is in jeopardy. You'll need to come up a few levels. No. The Defender's Vox caster has not been kicked, and is functioning better. Mara explained, then cut the connection. Bloody cog boy, cog girl. Aitra grumbled as she continued running up the spire. A few minutes later, Mara hailed her. I cannot provide a salamander, but the Magos has negotiated for a Valkyrie to meet you. Roger that, I owe you one, Mara. We do our duty, but if we are counting, you owe me four. One for this, one for repairing you, two for tolerating your rudeness and potential insanity. Aitra was very quiet for a moment, before Mara replied. That was a joke. Aitra breathed a sigh of relief. Mara, when the bugs are gone, we're gonna have to take a moment to discuss the finer points of humor. I look forward to it, Captain Aitra. Also, there is a lift shaft 20 meters to your south. Enjoy your flight. Aitra quickly took the lift upwards, raced another 2 miles up the spire, and came, breathing heavily, to the exit point. Outside, a Valkyrie waited for them, and they quickly piled in. As they flew, one of Aitra's squad made a comment. Plasma, Volk Transport, chatting with Tech Priests and crazy plans to kill things we never thought existed. Captain, for less than a day and you're turning us into Tempestus. You don't wanna be Tempestus, Sam. Aitra grumbled. They have to deal with this kind of bullshit all the time. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICBEDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. Kill Team Equinox Chapter 13, Preparations for the Hunt. As Aitra underwent her preparations and trial beneath the city, the Astartes prepared to hunt their own quarry. As their superhuman physiology restored their injuries, Wathin and Constantine sat and plotted. Or at least Wathin was plotting. Constantine rather fumed, largely in the silent, brooding way which is the manner of the Sons of Dawn. Wathin took note of this and raised the point. You're bored out of your mind, aren't you, laddie? I am not bored, merely unused to stagnancy. Constantine grumbled. Even when we wait for the enemy to come, or on the ships to reach the enemy, there is preparation, meditation, training, the construction of defenses. This immobility is unsettling. You're bored, Wathin summarized. And perhaps a bit overeager for battle. One can never be too eager to smite the enemies of the Emperor. One can if it breeds discontentment with peace, or costs you. Blood is the Emperor's currency, it must be spent well. Indeed, but I think you are overly cautious in this regard. We slew a Bio-Titan. What is a single crawling Xeno after that? We killed the Titan because it didn't consider us. Things like that are made to kill cities and other Titans. It doesn't give anything smaller than a tank notice, because nothing smaller than that is even a minor threat to it in most circumstances. In the Xeno's defense, I doubt even an actual Titan would have expected that particular maneuver. True, as the old sagas say again and again, cunning is a greater weapon than strength, and unpredictability is better than bowl shells. You are a veritable fountain of proverbs, old one. Comes packaged with the gray hair and longer fangs. Wathin grinned, displaying said elongated canines. But to return to the topic, we defeated the Titan because the Titan was not meant to kill us, and did not consider us. Elictor, he frowned. That is an entirely different kind of creature, more equivalent to you and I. It is a hunter unlike any other in the galaxy, and it is built to kill us. If we are overeager or arrogant, it will. Constantine heard the words of the Elder Marine, and saw they were tinged with bitter experience. Taking this under consideration, he nodded. Very well, I retract my accusation of overcautiousness. I have seen you are utterly fearless, to the point of insanity, and if you consider the Xeno such a threat, I will heed you. Insanity is relative, Wathin said with a shrug. Crazy like a wolf, so the saying goes. I thought it was like a fox. What in the Allfather's name is a fox? A form of ancient Terran canid, they were transported in early colony ships and spread throughout the galaxy, same as the other forms of canid. They were known as symbols of trickery on my world and many others I have fought upon. HM, interesting. Tell me of your world. I know that the Black Templars are drawn from many, and each one seems somewhat different. It is of little note, Constantine said with a shrug. It is a primitive one, brought within the Emperor's light shortly after I was born. It is ruled by warrior nobles, who gather forth and train skilled warriors for their youth to defend the people, for they were frequently raided by a vile Xeno species. The inhabitants called them the Drachii, the Dark Fairies, but I believe they were actually that corrupted subspecies of Elder. Curious. It actually sounds as though you may have something in common with Andriel. How so? Constantine bristled. Your world sounds quite similar to how the tales say Caliban was. But as it was destroyed in the Great Heresy, I believe the Lion's Sons draw from similar worlds now. He does not act like it, Constantine noted. Nor does he move like one trained from birth. He is a Start, a warrior of course, but not of the same caliber and origin. Well, he is a Sicker, Wathin said with a shrug. Perhaps. But there is something unusual in that one's origins besides his witchcraft. Bah, he's a Lion's Son. They all have secrets, but it's no secret that they have their secrets, which makes me think the tales they don't tell aren't half as interesting as they'd like to believe. Why bother with all the blatant skullduggery then? It does not befit a Start. Mystery is a powerful force. If it is known that an enemy has many secrets and knows many things, you will endeavor to uncover them. But if the blatantly hidden secrets are what you are focused on, you will not know what tales you hear are truth and which are deception, and the true secrets will remain hidden as you uncover paltry things. In this they maintain the advantage of deception and surprise, on which all warfare is based. Yes, such a thing does make sense. They are almost like the Raven Guard in that regard, but rather than denying sight they deny knowledge. Cunning. Constantine nodded with newfound respect. Albeit somewhat convoluted, the Emperor has many tools. Sometimes he needs an axe, sometimes a hammer, sometimes a blade, Wathin said with a shrug. Each legion is a weapon in the Allfather's arsenal, so that no enemy will be beyond his ken, and nothing shall escape his wrath. Not forever. Constantine growled. Wathin raised an eyebrow, but sensed a sore spot on the young warrior's honor. He did not pry, but rather diverted. Tell me, how did your chapter come to honor you by offering your vigil upon the Death Watch? Wathin asked. HM. In truth, I am not sure. I am by no means the most skilled slayer of the Xenos within the Eternal Crusade. I am inexperienced, having not even raised a single neophyte, and I approach only the first century of my service. I possess talent with the bleed, this much is true, but my battles against the Xenos have not seen any great victory. Perhaps a certain talent or record against the Elder? Wathin suggested. As befits your origin. I have participated in campaigns against the Elder, both the Corrupted and the merely Xenos, but I saw no particular success there. The nearest thing to that would be engaging one of their raid leaders, but he escaped me, and in truth I was outmatched by his skill. How did you know? You fight like you've fought them a great deal, and studied them in particular. You're sort of like an Alfenwenra, a berserker, but a different sort of trance. Sword trance, yes. It's somewhat rare and takes practice to activate, but it's nothing unusual. I simply learned it from my master, who learned it from his. Interesting. Perhaps when this is done, we shall hunt Elder together. I think I should like to see such a thing. Perhaps, if the Emperor wills it. Meanwhile, Ashvin concluded his meeting with Aether and her group, then returned to one of his own projects. Heading back to near the Manufactorum, he entered a large room, formerly for storage, but recently repurposed into an examination room. He was quite fortunate that Constantine had killed one of the tyrants so cleanly. The corpse was still mostly intact and waited now on the table. Its head was off to the side, while the main body slumped over the table. He decided to begin the dissection with the head, and he removed his gauntlets, replacing them with gloves to allow for finer movement. He then reached for a saw, and began to disassemble the Xenos. It was rougher work than he preferred, but necessary to understand the enemy on a more fundamental level. As he began to disassemble the brain, he happened upon something that gave him pause. He set his tools to the side and voxed Andriel. Brother Andriel, I think I may have discovered something interesting about the Tyranid physiology. Of course, I'll bring it up. He then removed his gloves, redonned his gauntlets, and carefully picked up the head. Andriel did a double take when he saw Ashvin approaching. He might have expected Wathin to arrive carrying the severed head of a Hive Tyrant, or possibly Constantine, but not the Salamander. He was even more confused when he saw that the head was partially dissected, and approached the Devastator Marine with some concern. I did not take you for a xenobiologist. The librarian admitted, surprised at the grisly trophy. I thought your chapter prided itself on crafting, not such endeavors. We construct many fine weapons and armors, this much is true, and metal is our specialty, but there are many weapons not made from iron. You and I, for example, are weapons forged from humanity and ancient sciences. Similarly, many of the Xenos are as much weapons themselves as wielders of weapons, and the Tyranid is a fine example of such. So you are seeking to understand the enemy's weapon by taking it apart. It makes sense, though it is still unexpected. Andriel conceded. I told you I had discovered something about their physiology. How do you think I did it? Just taking a bite? Ashvin joked. A fair point, cousin, though if you were a flesh tearer perhaps. Perhaps, but in this case it was examination, not ingestion. I was examining its brain when I discovered something that looked rather familiar. He pointed to a set of lobes in the brain, which Andriel examined. The Dark Angel's eyebrows rose, and he looked back to his staff. Indeed. It has a psychic amplifier grown in. Andriel shook his head. The staff is only a focus. It actually constrains my abilities, forcing them into a pattern I desire. To wield the power of the warp is not really a question of power. There is enough there to drown a star, but rather one of control. Though the Tyranid Seeker does not draw its power directly from the warp like you do, it instead draws it from the hive mind. Though even this would naturally require focus, and also, there's this. He explained, pulling back a section of the skull to reveal a thin gray layer of almost fabric-like growth. Andriel suspected immediately, and reached out his senses towards it. The reaction, like a thick fog, confirmed his suspicions. It's a dampener, the same as my hood. Not altogether surprising considering its composition. Aishvan raised a finger to ask, then stopped. I don't want to know, and you wouldn't tell me even if I did, correct? Exceedingly so. Ah, as I suspected. Well, that confirms a hypothesis, and grants me a greater degree of concern over our quarry. What do you mean? It is a lictor specialized for hunting sickers, and the hive mind is capable of growing psychically dampening material on the interior of a hive tyrant skull. A lictor operates as an ambush predator. Would it not also contain an adaptation to conceal itself from its prey? Andriel scowled. Yes, that makes altogether too much sense. Unfortunately, I've never fought anything with skin that dampens psychic powers, so I have no idea just how effective such an adaptation would be. Well, it does offer one advantage. Aishvan replied cheerily. The stuff is highly flammable. Andriel chuckled. And I am once again reassured that I am speaking to a salamander. Though with your interest in such things, I am somewhat surprised that you are not an apothecary. Aishvan smiled broadly. You honor me, brother, but I am far too young to be given such a responsibility. Perhaps I shall be granted it if I perform my vigil well, but I cannot say. Perhaps? The Dark Angel replied. Though you seem far more suited to this work than I am, in truth, not entirely certain why I was seconded. My service is not that much longer than yours. Aishvan shrugged. The hood makes you look older, I suppose, and as for the method of choosing, I am uncertain. I volunteered, so that I might gain a greater understanding of our enemies and my battle brothers alike. Andriel smiled at the salamander's optimism. Well then, brother, let us hope you do not find understanding of what it is to be killed by that enemy. It would be a great loss to the galaxy. The kill team Ray assembled an hour later, briefing a Serf Sadid Wathin and Constantine in Ray donning their armor. The only one not physically present was Andriel, who remained guarding the astropaths, and instead projected an image of himself into the room. Aishvan briefed the rest of the team on his findings and hypothesis about the lictor's potential psychic resilience, to which Wathin let out a low whistle. Cunning, and nasty business besides. I knew they adapted, but an adaptation on this scale, for this purpose? It reeks of intelligent design, not merely a helpful response to stimuli. Morn nodded. The intelligence of the hive mind is poorly understood. It is not impossible that it has the capacity to specifically craft a variant on the bioform to suit a specific purpose. A variant specifically designed to prey upon sickers is not an impossibility if they had previously encountered blanks or similar entities. I wasn't aware that the Xenos had souls to be soulless. Constantine admitted. You confuse the religious implication with the practical application. Andriel explained. A soul is very much a physical thing, simply existing within the immaterium. Everything that thinks has one, even if its thoughts are very basic. With the exceptions of blanks. Morn concurred. A null lictor. It is an interesting hypothesis. Andriel shook his head. It's not a null, the resistance is part of its makeup. A psychic hood effectively. He gestured to his own hood. This doesn't make me a null, it simply makes me more difficult to detect and resistant to warp energies. It wouldn't be completely immune, just difficult to pierce. We'll have to conduct a more extensive examination of the corpse. I'm curious to see if my hypothesis holds true. Aishvan explained. Though considering its threat level, I doubt there will be much of it remaining to examine. We can store the corpse and examine it in greater detail back on the Watch Fortress. Morn advised. If you hold true and it is a new variant bioform, it will need a new designation. A hooded lictor. Aishvan suggested. Simple, gets the point across. We'll have to see if it has an actual hood, or that may raise a few questions. Constantine noted as he donned his helmet. I recommend Warp Smoke Lictor. We can name it after we kill it. Morn stated practically. The Xenos' resistance to psychic screeing combined with the presence of the shadow in the warp denies us the arcane means of tracking, and so logic must suffice. He raised up a new map, showing the pattern of disappearances. It is working its way up the main spires, evading patrols and cameras. However, I have found a way to track its progress. A number of low-level sickers yet to be sanctified have been released under commissarial supervision to act as markers. When they go dark, it means that the lictor has moved by. Ashvin's expression was unreadable, watching the lights on the map closely. It occurs to me, if they are targeting sickers, would they not also potentially engage the containment cells? He asked, referring to the dungeons in which unsanctioned sickers were held until the black ships could arrive. Due to the effects of the shadow and the warp, the majority of said cells were purged. Those that remained were both the weakest and the most stable. All others either went mad or were given the Emperor's mercy before their powers could overwhelm them. Morn explained coldly. The ones currently deployed are all that remain. A pity. Ashvin noted. Still, their willingness to serve in such a condition does mark the remainder well. Even witches may serve the Emperor. They are tainted, but in duty there is penance. Constantine replied dogmatically. By the Emperor, that was almost tolerant of your brother. Andriel noted wryly. Cousin. I have had to adapt to my situation. You are still an abomination, but you are a start, and a member of my kill team. It is inevitable that your corrosive presence would force me to compromise, albeit temporarily. Andriel smirked under his hood, but Morn interrupted. You can continue your inane bickering in the transport back to the Watch Fortress. Look now, Sector 129. The light is gone out. We have our target. Aye. That we do. All specs to maximum, lads. We're on the hunt. Wathin growled, crinkling his sensitive nose. By this point the Astartes had become accustomed enough to the hive that they were able to move between the hab blocks and transport lanes with the ease of those who had lived there for a lifetime. In fact, considering the somewhat limited movements of many hive inhabitants, they probably knew the city better. Navigating through the tunnels at high speed, they moved towards the next likely target of the lictor. As they traveled, they were briefly halted by a line of crackling light. The line expanded, and Andriel stepped through the Gate of Infinity, cracking his neck as he did so, and falling in with the rest of the team. Ashvin raised an eyebrow under his helmet. Teleporting onto a moving target, impressive. You all shine brighter than anything else in this city, bar the astropaths. Andriel replied. Wathin's axe in particular. Ashvin looked towards the space wolf curiously, who grinned and chuckled. Always bring a bit of home with you. He replied enigmatically. Particularly when your home's as potent a world as Fenris. Andriel looked at the space wolf quizzically. Your chapter doesn't call it sickers, does it? The rune priests aren't sickers in the usual sense. Their power comes from Fenris, not the warp. Even in the Halo Stars? Always bring a piece from home, and the runes always work, far as I can gather. I'm not a priest. Wathin replied with a shrug. They quickly approached the location of the next sicker, but found they had arrived too late. Wathin growled even as the supposedly secured room opened. The reek of blood was clear. The kill team entered quickly, looking about. It was an empty, formerly white room, with two chairs and nothing else. Formerly white, as it was now splattered with blood. The decapitated corpse of the sicker lay on the floor, though the head was nowhere to be found as usual. Nearby, the tattered remnants of a corpse lay scattered. Only the color of the shredded coat and still mostly intact fancy hat explained it was the remains of a commissar. Her severed arm, still holding their signature bolt pistol, lay against the opposite wall. She had fought back, but only one round had been fired. Ashvin knelt by the body and moved its remaining arm over her chest. As he began to close her eyes respectfully, he noted something. There were a series of holes bored into the commissar's skull. Instantly, the hypno training activated, and Ashvin found himself standing in a flashback. He sat in a stone chair, almost resembling a throne in the Watch Fortress. Images flashed before him on a screen, fast enough that even his conscious mind could not process them, but his unconscious could. The lictor possessed many adaptations to make it a superb infiltrator. Its carapace was chameleonic, and it was armed with dangerous flesh hooks to drag prey into reach of its mighty rending claws. However, its most terrifying adaptation was the feeder maw, a series of bone-tipped tentacles which bored into the skull and consumed the brain. From this, the lictor would gain all the knowledge the victim possessed. The commissar had known the plan, or at least part of it. Now the lictor did too. Ishvan shot up and shouted a warning. It knows. Instantly the kill team went on full alert, but it was barely swift enough. Andriel's defenses activated at the speed of thought, a psychic barrier deflecting a bone hook which struck from apparently nowhere. The lictor recovered swiftly, launching a second hook at Morn before the Techmarine sensors could even recognize it was there. The hook bit into the elbow joint of his armor and into the metal arm before. There was a ripping sound as the Xeno hurled the Techmarine across the room like a toy. Morn hit the opposite wall hard, cracking the permacrete and throwing up a cloud of dust. His left arm sparked uselessly, the fingers twitching. Constantine's battle focus activated, adrenaline surging through his brain and slowing the world. His mind went into overdrive as two parallel futures arched in front of him. He couldn't see the lictor in the present clearly, a blur of chameleonic light moving at speeds even the space marine couldn't hope to match. He could see where it would be though. It had engaged its flesh hooks, now it would use its speed to seek its target in melee. In one future, it rushed upon the wounded Morn and severed his head. In the other, the biological programming led it to attack Andriel. The world moved in slow motion. He saw the energy of the warp flickering indigo around Andriel, the light of Prometheum emerging from the barrel of Ishvan's Slamer, heard the hammer of Wathin's bolt pistol striking the bolt round. But even in this state, the lictor moved, now visible, but moving at what would seem to be a casual walk. He had known the creature was large, but he had not expected just how large. This monster was nearly twice his height and moved as swiftly as Drakhari Witch. He could not intercept both futures. So he changed the rules. He hurled his knife towards the future that attacked Morn, and stepped in front of Andriel, power sword moving to parry where the attack would be. The knife struck the wall and embedded into it, and power sword met monstrous claw in a storm of sparks and searing flesh. No flesh, no matter how resilient or how well gene crafted, could withstand the energetic edge of a power weapon. The lictor screamed, pulling away as its lethal arm fell to the ground. Ishvan fired his flamer hastily, still on one knee and rising as he did so. The Prometheum flame washed over Constantine and Andriel. The mighty power armor of the Astartes bore the blinding flame without even scorch mark, and flickering energy fields warded Andriel's exposed head. But even this nearly instantaneous reaction was not enough. The lictor, already backpedaling away from Constantine, pivoted with remarkable agility, sidestepping the flamer's blast. Wathin, acting more on instinct than anything else, fired his bolt pistol several times in a second, each shot aiming for an area where the lictor might evade. Only one was successful, striking the beast in the shoulder and wounding it as it evaded the flame. Reacting swiftly, the monster lashed out with its flesh hooks, tearing the bolt pistol from Wathin's hand. Changing tact, it rushed Morn as the Techmarine rose to his feet. It closed swifter than a warning could reach, the speed and mass of its passing blowing away the dust. Morn fired from the hip, two shots smashing into the Xeno's midsection and throwing off its attack. He ducked to the side, the Bioforge blade slashing off a section of his helmet, but only grazing the skin beneath. At the same moment, the Hellfire rounds exploded, blasting chunks out of the Xeno's and melting through its body like their namesake. Recognizing its situation, the lictor proved itself to be among the most intelligent of all tyrannid lifeforms by attempting to retreat. It moved down the hallway, blurring out of sight to strike again. But Andriel would not allow it. Reaching out with his mind, he felt his power push against the lictor, like pushing through a thick curtain. As suspected, it was resistant to direct psychic attacks. Instead, he formed his power into a blade, and sheared off a section of the ceiling to crush the impudent bug. Again, the lictor's inhuman reflexes preserved it, stopping and pulling back from the falling slab. Andriel cared not, pulling the slab back to strike the Xeno in the chest, pushing it back towards the kill team and pinning its legs under the heavy permacrete. It struggled to break free, immobilized only for a moment. Ishvan took that moment, stepping forwards and filling the corridor with fire. The lictor staggered out, having torn off one of its own legs in its desperation to live. The fire had struck it in the face, blinding the creature. The heat had scorched the chameleonic carapace as well, blackening it and revealing the full horror of the beast for the first time. It moved sluggishly, but only for a moment, before Wathin and Constantine hit it at once. The mighty axe split the beast in half, while the swift blade severed the monstrous head. The creature hit the ground with a crash, instantly slain. The whole encounter had transpired over the course of roughly 20 seconds, but even so the Astartes took a moment to catch their breaths. The adrenaline rush faded, and they took another 8 seconds to compose themselves and evaluate the situation before they spoke again. Well done predicting its movements. Wathin told Constantine. That trick with the knife was nicely done. You did well yourself. I only saw 2 places for it to go, but you saw what? 4? And where it was if it decided to stand still, they do that occasionally. Wathin said with a grin. You'll learn to predict more as you get older. Morn turned to Ishvan gratefully, reloading his bolter as his Macadon trites repaired his damaged arm. It seems that compassion occasionally has its benefits beyond morale. Compassion, and several days of hypno training every Xeno the Imperium has ever faced into your head. Ishvan said with a smile under his helmet. Yes, but that is not exclusive to you on this team. Constantine turned from the lictor towards Andriel, and the two nodded at one another. Well fought, witch. You also, Templar. Ishvan began to examine the corpse, using his knife to saw through the carapace and examine the body. Aha. I knew it. He said, pulling free a layer of grey material. It is a new bioform. Morn flexed each of his fingers individually, made a fist, and nodded. We shall have to write a report upon our return. Then a report appeared in his information feed. Another light had gone dark, then another report, something large, fast, and difficult to see was moving very rapidly up the spire. He froze, dedicating all his energies into calculating an explanation. The hive mind had placed a high priority on this mission, dedicating substantial forces in order first to infiltrate the lictor and then distract from its presence with the genestealers. It was a new bioform, specifically created for this purpose. If it was such a high priority to destroy the sickers that all these resources were committed to it, would it not also make sense to ensure there was a contingency? And furthermore, to coordinate in the manner only a hive mind could to conceal the existence of that contingency. And now, having obtained knowledge of the plan and the death of its partner, the other would proceed with all speed towards the highest concentration of sickers in the hive before it was destroyed. There were 2. Morn warned, and began to sprint. The kill team took an instant to process this, then turned and ran to follow him. Andriel paused, gathering his powers to open a gate and teleport to the destination directly, but Constantine raised his blade to stop him. Can you bring us all? He asked. No. Andriel admitted. Then you run. We cannot face this enemy alone. Andriel nodded, and redoubled his pace. Space Marines at a full sprint are a sight to behold, practically flying from stride to stride in a surprisingly graceful motion. All those who saw them quickly threw themselves out of the way lest they be trampled. As they ran, Morn began to hail their forces. The lictor has breached containment and is attempting to assassinate the astropathic choir, unable to contain. Repeat, lictor is attempting to terminate the astropathic choir, unable to contain. Request immediate support. A few moments later, Aitra hailed him in turn. Roger that, Lord Morn, my brigade is on its way. And so they raced onwards, pushing themselves to the limits of their superhuman physiques in a desperate move to stop the hive mind's plot. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. Kill Team Equinox Chapter 15, Sacrifices. The kill team raced up the spire, chasing the lictor through the winding streets and through the endless stairs and lift platforms. They were approximately halfway down, about 2 kilometers below the heavily defended and warded building that served as the Hive's astropathic choir, and 5 kilometers from the pinnacle of this particular spire. If they could move directly, they would reach it in roughly 3 minutes moving at their top speed. However, the lifts, stairs, and curves greatly extended the Astartes' pathway and delayed their progress. The lictor, by contrast, would suffer no such delays. Despite its absurd bulk, it was able to move through areas smaller than its frame would suggest, and could just as easily scale the side of the spire as going through it. As Morn was processing this, he recognized the solution. Up the side. He ordered, charging for a wall and opening fire on it. The rounds bitten and blasted the permacrete apart, and then the charging marine smashed through it and the steel plates on the exterior. Morn moved out past the boundary of the spire into the open air. 5 kilometers below the black asphalt of the city's artificial floor stared back up at him. He began to fall, but turned as he did, undeterred by the dizzying height. His boots met the steel exterior of the spire, and stuck with a clunk. He took several steps backwards to reduce his momentum, then began to sprint up the side of the building, racing up it like a lizard. The rest of the kill team swiftly followed in their own way. Constantine was the swiftest, firing his jump pack to reorient himself and land above the hole the Techmarine had punched. Shortly after, Andriel stepped out into the air and levitated himself, turning on nothing to stick to the wall. Wathin simply bit his axe onto the side of the hole and used it to swing himself around, laughing uproariously as he did so. Aishvin was the slowest, pausing briefly to secure his flamer, then gingerly locking his boots to the base of the hole and coming around in the most controlled manner, as his greater bulk required. And so they made their path straight, even if not entirely direct. Moving upwards while gravity pulled them back would have been agonizingly slow for any mortal, but the Astaire's superior sense of balance allowed them to accomplish the feat at impossible speed. Even so, their great bulk forced them to move cautiously, advancing at only 2/3 of their maximum stride, which nonetheless remained twice as swift as a human running on flat ground. Occasionally, the metal armor they relied upon for traction was damaged or moved aside for an unarmored section, in which case they were obliged to leap across it like a vertical ravine. If they did not possess the peculiar focus which once again sets the Astartes apart from mortals, they would have perhaps marveled at their fantastic situation. An outside observer would have perceived them as Goliath silhouettes, framed against the setting sun. The smoke and pollution of the Great Hive turned the fading sunlight blood red, and it seemed an ascent like that of Orpheus and Dante, rising from purgatorial torment to a gilded heaven. Indeed, the upper parts of the spires, where the smoke was faint enough for light to be golden, were gilded. They shone brightly in the fading sun, so much so that when the lictor passed onto that new section of the spire, they spied it for a brief moment. Its carapace flickered in the light, shifting from the black and grey to the luxurious gold of the upper spire. Constantine hurled curses and oaths at it, Mournbowl shells. The lictor was still far ahead of them, well out of the conventional range of a bolter. But Morn was not a conventional marine. His inbuilt cogitator, working in concert with his superhuman mind, calculated the distance and arc needed to strike the foe. He fired in arc, a full burst, and only after this recognized the error. He had adjusted to moving on the vertical plane like a horizontal one, and in his haste attempted to arc his shots as if gravity were beneath his feet. However, he instead missed, and the bolt shells fell uselessly past him. On their way down, one of them had the ill fortune to strike a bust of an imperial saint. It passed through the head and exploded within, raining marble down on the streets below. The lictor had a head start on the space marines, and furthermore its companion had demonstrated that the bioform was swifter than them. They would not be as far behind it as they might have been, thanks to their innovative approach, but it was still ahead. Even if Constantine had fired his jump pack at full burst, he would not be able to close the gap in time. The effect was clear, it would reach the choir first. Both Morn and Andriel contacted the choir and its defenders, and told them to prepare for the worst. there were relatively few lone creatures in the galaxy that would pose a serious threat to the astropaths. While blind, their psychic powers were potent enough to cross between sectors, granting them better perception than most with their sight. Their powers were specialized for communication, but they were still powerful telepaths and able to wield the warp for offensive purposes. While individually weak, the full choir could rival or even surpass Andriel's psychic might. However, the inability to detect the lictor in the psychic field would make them truly blind to its presence. Furthermore, while telepathic attack was capable of laying low even the most physically mighty adversary, it was worse than useless against the Tyranid. That screaming mass of countless primitive minds would drown out any telepathic attack, potentially even infesting the connection and driving the connected individual to utter insanity. Thus the astropaths were helpless before the lictor. They could all run the numbers, they would arrive approximately 1 minute behind the lictor at their current speed. It would still be too late. Then a shadow passed over the estates, and they turned to see a Valkyrie passing by them. Aitra looked out the side to see the space marines sprinting up the side of the building, catching a flicker of moment quite a ways out ahead of them, nearly level with the landing pad. "There's our target," she shouted over the sound of the Valkyrie's engines. "The marines?" one of her squad asked in confusion. "No Groks for brains, that thing, above them," she shouted, pointing harder. Despite pointing hard and not actually making anything more visible, unless you are a sicker, which Aitra was not, the guardsman did see it. "What the hell is that? I can barely see it." "Our target. Doesn't matter what it is, the marines want it dead and need us to help make it that way," Aitra replied coldly. "Are you crazy? We can't even see it, how are we going to kill that?" "We're not. We just need to slow it down enough for the marines to catch up so they can kill it. Now stop bitching and check your charge." The pilot of the Valkyrie, sensors not showing any threat, began to put down. She knew speed of was of the essence, but had yet to spy the lictor. Fortunately for her, the Xeno had other concerns. As the thrusters began to fire for landing, the lictor reached the landing pad and began to move towards the large spherical building in which the astropaths were housed. 60. The guardsmen set to defend the astropaths were as prepared as they could be. They had two heavy bolter emplacements armed and ready, and were already on edge. However, distracted by the landing Valkyrie and the sound of space marines running up the side of a hive spire, they did not see it coming. The first they knew of it was when a pair of flesh hooks dug into the sergeant and one of the gunners, then hurled them off the side of the spire. They fired wildly into the air, unable to strike the creature with enough precision to damage it. Four were cloven in half by the massive arms, and a fifth went down as the lictor's jaw distended and a swarm of bone-tipped tendrils punched through his head. The survivors broke and fled, some hurling themselves from the spire. 50. Aitra and her command squad leapt from the Valkyrie. Estimating the lictor's position by the storm of blood and viscera, she raised her plasma gun. "Open fire," she ordered, and a storm of plasma struck everything in the general vicinity. The Xeno was already on the move, evading most of the lethal blue fire. Only a glancing blow caught it, setting one of its back legs ablaze. It let out an alien scream as it rushed for the door. The squad moved up, shifting their sights towards the burning limb. The lictor carved the door out of the wall with its curved blade arms, then seized it with its flesh hooks and flung it with incredible strength back towards the squad. They dove for cover, but one was too slow. The door struck him in the chest and he went down. Aitra ordered the medic to stabilize him, and the remaining three guard raced for the door. 40. As he raced up the side of the spire, Andriel felt a spike of pain slam through his senses. He staggered, nearly falling. Aishvan reached out a hand, stabilizing the librarian as he shook his head. It took him a precious instant to recover and recognize the source of the pain. "Death scream. It's inside." 35. Aitra and her squad raced into the astropathic building. They immediately felt an odd sense of peace. Such areas were built to isolate the psychic noise and ensure the calm of its inhabitants. Its walls were built and warded to keep away the background noise of a hive, and so it was oddly still. The interior of the building was pitch black, as lights were unnecessary for a choir of the blind. It was perhaps the most peaceful place that any of them had ever been in. The fact that it was that, in spite of the decapitated corpse on the floor and the screams of panicking astropaths, was a testament both to its effectiveness and the sheer chaos of a guardsman's existence. The squad activated their lights almost instantly, casting beams into the darkness. They swept in all directions for the lictor, eyes straining to see it. Then Atra spotted another source of light, a series of blue plasma embers. Turning, she fired, and her men followed suit. As the flash of plasma illuminated the darkness, they saw that it was just the leg, severed from the body and left as bait. As soon as she recognized this, Atra opened her mouth to shout a warning. Instead, she screamed, as something bit into her shoulder and arm. She went flying into the darkness, smashing into the wall hard enough that her helmet cracked apart. Lightning covered her arm, then all was darkness and nausea. 15. Atra vaguely saw, through blurry vision, the lights of her squad's plasma guns fall to the floor. Why had they dropped them? They needed to fight the Xeno, and those were valuable. Did they have any idea how much trouble? Oh, where was hers? There it was. Why was it floating? And so large? Why did her arm hurt so much, but at the same time why couldn't she feel her fingers on that hand? Andriel forced his thoughts into a wall, a barrier of energy forming around him. The astropaths were being slaughtered, their death cries slamming against him like the waves of a great ocean. He was falling behind. Go. It is among them. He shouted to his battle brothers, moving forwards as the backlash of so many dead threatened to throw him from the spire. 0. The space marines came up over the spire, and moved at last at their full speed. Their passage was like thunder, and like a righteous wind. The medic heard them go, but by the time she looked to see they were already gone. Andriel staggered up a moment later, then charged bravely after them. The marines moved into the building, already sweeping, each brother covering the other's line of sight. Constantine spied movement, and fired his jets, sweeping forwards hastily to strike the enemy. As he moved through the air, he saw that they were not the lictor, but three astropaths, their limbs severed, but still alive. Then the lictor moved, slicing the heads from the three in a single motion. Outside, the combined backlash blew Andriel off his feet like an electric shock. Constantine raised his blade to defend, and met the Xeno in a flash of sparks. Constantine went flying, his power sword falling from his grasp and striking the floor. Its field sparked uselessly, blade bent from the fall. As Constantine crashed into the opposite wall, Wathen moved forwards, firing at the area around the downed Templar. His axe was ready, but the lictor did not move to finish the fallen marine, merely using him as yet another distraction. Instead, it moved from the flank. Aishvin and Morn saw it, turning to fire. But the flesh hooks were faster. The roar of the flamer was cut to a whimper as the fuel line was severed. Another hook bit into Aishvin's side and hauled him forwards. The lictor launched itself over the salamander, using him as a platform to leap yet further and strike Morn. The Techmarine fired, but not swiftly enough. The Xeno bore him to the ground under its bulk. Behind it, the force of its leap sent Aishvin tumbling forwards. Detaching his now useless weapon from his armor, he rolled to his feet, but too slowly. One of Morn's bolters went skittering across the floor, while the other fired uselessly. The Xeno had one arm pinned, but Morn had managed to slip the other one free. The lictor's head dipped forwards towards Morn's, but the iron arm interposed itself, holding the monster back. Its jaw distended once again, and the ripper maw dove down. The tendrils scraped and screamed against the ceramite of Morn's helmet, but one found a weak point. It punched through the reinforced glass of his left eye hole, and down into the cybernetic eye beneath. Sensors screamed in Morn's head, and the hydraulics of his arm creaked. The deadly tendril was extended to its maximum, but was held mere centimeters away from the marine's brain. The arm began to scream, even steel yielding before the weight and purpose of the deadly Xeno. But then something distracted the monster, just for a moment. Its weight increased slightly, and it shifted back as something leapt upon its back. Its head turned slightly, allowing Morn to see what had caused the disturbance. Atra, one arm torn to shreds, helmet gone, and hair matted with blood, hung on with her legs to the lictor. Her plasma gun was jammed into a gap in its armor, and her eyes blazed even brighter. The plasma charge built with a hiss, then a scream, then a wail. Morn shut his one remaining eye, then a blue sun filled the astropathic chamber. Atre's body went flying to the side, as the lictor reared back, screaming in pain. Half of its body was virtually gone, and what remained was wreathed in azure fire. As it fell, Aishvan fell upon it with his bare hands. Undeterred by any flame, the salamander seized the Xeno by the midsection and hauled it back, uttering a bellow of such fury that even Wathin paused for an instant. The Xeno writhed under the Devastator's grip, but his strength was unmatched. With a crack, he broke the creature, and in a moment of indiscriminate violence, he tore it in half, and crushed its skull under his boot. Andriel arrived just as this occurred, and swept the area grimly. Still smoking faintly from the backlash, he looked about for survivors. Seeing none, he helped Morn to his feet. The Techmarine brushed past his concerns and moved with speed. Constantine turned to Aishvan, in awe of the salamander's raw strength. "Cousin, remind me to never make you angry," he acknowledged. Aishvan did not respond, but followed Morn. The Techmarine had moved with all speed to Atra's side, and there was a hiss as his fire contingency is activated, dousing the flames that racked the Guard's woman's body. Atra's body was ruined. Her entire right arm was gone, and the left was mangled beyond repair. Her hair had all burned off, and the entire right side of her body was blackened. The flesh on the right side of her face had been burned off to the bone in places, and her eye was gone. Her torso was similarly damaged, parts of it simply gone, disintegrated along with her arm in the blast. Still though, she dragged in shallow, ragged breaths, her body so badly damaged it was incapable of going into shock. She was not bleeding, every wound cauterized to charcoal. It was only a matter of time before her body simply gave up though, unable to sustain such injuries. Her remaining eye flickered about in pain and terror. She knew she was dying, but still fought for life valiantly. Her remaining fingers twitched, her legs spasmed slightly. Her eye met Morn's, and she opened her mouth, trying to speak, but her throat was too badly burned. Aishvan laid a hand on Morn's shoulder gently, as the Techmarine examined the Guard's woman. Wordlessly, the salamander's hand drifted towards the bolt pistol on his hip. "No," Morn said, and a mounted device on his arm whirred, and a syringe pierced her neck. Atra spasmed, her breaths becoming more rapid, her heart continuing to beat in spite of the tremendous injuries. "Morn, that will only prolong her suffering. Her body cannot survive this," Aishvan said warningly, his grip becoming tighter, that same dangerous anger still smoldering and threatening to wake to life. The Techmarine whirled on him and met him with an iron stare, baleful and unyielding. Aishvan met that gaze, the lone iron eye, and the twisted wreck of scrap that was once an eye. He saw how very nearly Morn's long service had come to an end, and for an instant, he felt something he had not truly felt since he had become a full battle brother. Fear. Aishvan took a step back, uncertain now of how to handle the situation. Morn gently lifted up the fallen Guard's woman, practically cradling her. "Indeed. Flesh is weak, even that of the few worthy servants of the Omnigia. So iron must preserve it, for it cannot go to waste." Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time. Time.